And this time we're going to click export data. And then you can choose to download as an Excel file or a CSV file. And it should pop up just like that.
Welcome, everyone. My name is Kim Larson. I'm a client success manager here at Luminoso. And today I'm joined by Lila Hardesty, who will be teaching us how to scrape online reviews. I'll go over the data file format stuff and how you can use online reviews for business use cases. But to start it off, I'll pass the mic to Lila.
Yeah, and I'll be teaching you how to actually use it. So to get started, you'll need to add the web scraper extension shown here from the Chrome Web Store. In this example, we'll be scraping reviews from Amazon. So first, you'll need to inspect the page in order to access the inspect pane. From here, you can click on those three little dots, the kebab menu, in order to move your inspect pane to the bottom of your page. This is just a personal choice, but I find it's easier to view the page if you move it to the bottom. From here, you can navigate to your web scraper, which will be listed along the top as one of your options. And then in some cases, you might have to close out the What's New console if this is the first time you've opened your inspect pane. Next, we'll be creating our sitemap. So this is how you tell the scraper what you want it to scrape. You'll start by naming it. In this case, we give it the name of the site and what we're scraping, and then you'll copy the link and paste that as the start URL. Most review sites have multiple pages of reviews, so pagination is a helpful tool in order to scrape them all. You can do this by adding a new selector and then giving it an ID, a name to call it by, which we'll just do pagination, and then you select the type, which again, in this case, is pagination. Now, once you've done that, you can then navigate to the bottom of the page and find the element that will take you to the next page. Here on Amazon, it's the next page button. So then we'll navigate to the selector to select that element. And so once you've done that, once you've clicked the select button, you can then select the next page and then in some cases, hit the C button to make sure you've selected the actual element. Then you can hit done selecting and save that selector. Next, we'll create the review container that will hold all the information you want to scrape. So you've done that by actually navigating inside the pagination folder, then adding a new selector and naming this one review, and then selecting the type element. So that way you can choose the element on the page that is the review. So then you'll want to click the selector in order to select it and make sure you have the entire box of the review, not all the reviews on the page, but just one review that contains all the information that you would like to scrape. It's a little tricky to get, but then once you click it, you can then scroll down the page and then also click the next review below it. That way you're going to be able to scrape every review on the page. Once you've seen them all highlighted, you can then click done selecting and make sure that the multiple checkbox is clicked so that every one of those is a piece of information to scrape. Cool. We'll then navigate into the review container by selecting its ID. And from here, we can start adding all the data that we would like to scrape. So you could do add a new selector. In this case, we're just gonna do the text. So just leave as type text. And then you can select the review text on the page that is held within the container and click done selecting on that. And then you can save that selector.
Sweet.
So this will be repeated as needed for every piece of data that you would like to scrape inside your container. Here we'll be grabbing the rating. So that will be the stars that you can see on the page next to the title of the review. Right now we're just naming it. And in this case, we're going to want to do a different type. It's going to be a type element attribute. And then you're going to select on the page the stars. Now, some of this knowledge has come from beforehand, from actually going through the HTML. That's why I know we need to use element attribute here. But once you've done that, you can then click the title because that will give us the data that we want. That's the attribute of the element that we would like to scrape. And in some cases, it's helpful to use the data preview button in order to make sure that you're actually scraping, you've selected what data you'd like to scrape. Then you can save that selector and we can add another one. because there's more data on the page that we still like to scrape. In this case, we're going to be scraping the title. So we just call that one title, as we've decided, you know, we'll trial and error. In this case, it'll be again type text, so we can just leave it as that. And then we can select on the page the title. And then we're going to check just to make sure that is the base element. And then we can click done selecting and save that selector as well. Now we're going to add another one. This one will be the date. Very important piece of information to scrape when you're scraping reviews. Again, it's going to be text. As you can see, it's just written out here on the page. Unfortunately, it is going to come with that extra text of the reviewed in the United States, but it'll be fine. Can deal with that later. You can hit done selecting and save that selector as well.
Good. And then I think, is it repeating?
It's repeating, yeah, because it's doing rating.
Cool.
Okay, from here we can start our quality insurance portion. So that will just be clicking on the data preview button inside the entire review container, making sure that you've grabbed every piece of information and it's looking how you expected it to look. We can also just, you know, we found that we actually don't want to call this string rating. We are going to want to call it score. So, you know, just checking over, make sure you've titled things correctly, because that will be what comes out once you've actually scraped it.
Yep. And from the CSM perspective, the things that we're looking for, and we'll cover this in a second, we want the text field, the thing to be analyzed. We want to make sure that we're having everything we need. So if you need location, you're including location, the star rating, the title, the date, and you're not pulling in that irrelevant stuff like the header, or if there's images that can't be analyzed in text. Emojis are okay, but the like .png files, you don't necessarily want to include those in the scrape.
Okay, and then we're going to do this section again, you know, just we'll check it over again. We're going to do this in pagination this time. So we've moved back to that folder, and we're going to make sure that every review on the page, the same data is being scraped from it. I mean, not the same data in every review, right? But that we're getting what we're expecting. And again, making sure that everything's right. Now from there, you can actually scrape the data. So you do that by clicking on the sitemap portion and then clicking on the scrape button. As shown again, clicking on that sitemap, we're gonna actually select scrape. And then all you have to do is click start scraping, and then it'll start scraping and a new window should pop up. And so that will be the window that the extension will actually be scraping from.
Cool.
Then you're basically done, and all you need to do is collect the data you've scraped. So you can click the refresh button, and this is done just to make sure that data actually was scraped when it happened and that's still looking right. And then you can navigate back up to the sitemap. And this time we're going to click export data, and then you can choose to download as an Excel file or a CSV file. And it should pop up just like that. So a few HTML basics can come in handy when scraping from websites. Here we are showing you the HTML code from the site, which can be found in the elements section of your inspect pane. Basically, everything on this site is an element. So that's like when you were seeing those highlighted blue portions, that was when you were hovering over code that pointed to that element. Each element also has a class with attributes connected to it. So that's how I knew earlier on that we needed to do the element attribute for scraping the rating, the stars, because those had an attribute that was called title, and that had the text that we needed to actually get the number of stars from that. And then pagination is basically just a fancy word for the element on the page that contains for the element on the page that contains code to take you to the next page. So that would just be the next button. That's when holds that code.
Gotcha. So if a new person to scraping is stuck on which class to pick, a way to figure out what class they need is to go to this element section and hover over the thing that they want?
Yeah, so basically you can just see that once you've gotten, you start big and get smaller. So we'll start with highlighting the entire page, and then you can click on that drop down and search through that to where it's highlighting just the reviews section of the page. scroll through that a bit, find where it's highlighting just the review itself. And you keep going through that path until you reach the point of the element that you're trying to scrape. And then you can see written out, you know, maybe sometimes it's ID, sometimes it's title, and often there's a class. And in those, that will be the attribute that you might want to scrape.
Gotcha. So if someone decided, like, yes, I want the verified purchase status included in the scrape, they can go through this and figure that out. Cool.
Yeah, exactly.
So now that we have the file, we can start to format it to put it into Daylight. So the first step that we'll say with every data source, not just with product reviews, is make sure that the text is storyful, that there's enough connective tissue between concepts for the AI to really grab onto and give you something interesting. The next piece is protecting the science, and occasionally, if your data set is smaller, spell checking the feedback. The AI trusts the data that it's fed. So if you have Adderall with one A, two L's, and one O, one L, it's going to believe the data that these are two different concepts. And for your analysis, you may want them to be the same. So if you do spell check, you can consolidate some of those things and get better associations around the preferred or accurate spelling of things. If you're doing something like a survey, we'll also recommend cleaning out disqualifying answers. So NA, none, keyboard smashing, the AI will identify those as concepts when you run it. So you want to make sure you take those out to just get that storyful feedback to be able to surface what is the story being told by this audience. Once you have the data file, one of the things that we like to do is take out the fields that are not going to be helpful and make sure we're adding fields that are going to be helpful. So in this case, we have this rating, but the format from the scrape does not align with what I need in Daylight. In Daylight, the score is a number. 4.0 out of 5 stars is not a strict number. It's a string of text that includes numbers. So what I'll do is I'll replace the string of words into a number that we can work with. So I'll use find and replace in Excel, replace those. In this case, we also have dates that are in a string of words. So I'll want to replace that with dates as well. It's usually not very difficult to do that find and replace, but you want to be careful sometimes if you have multi-digit numbers, because if you start with the low end, you may end up replacing things in the double digit numbers that can cause a mess. Be careful, be strategic, be thoughtful. So next thing is adding supplementary data that is really helpful, but may not necessarily be included in the scrape. For example, the source. If you're scraping Amazon, Best Buy, Chewy, Target, whatever, you want to include an extra field like Amazon as the retailer. That way, if you add more sources, you can differentiate where this review is posted. We'll touch on that in a second. The other thing we'll want to touch on is the product or brand. These reviews did not include which product was being reviewed because that was innate to the subset that we scraped. So we want to include maybe our product name, the product size, the price, whatever data you know about the product that you're analyzing, you'll want to extrapolate that and put that in the data so that you have it available later in case you want to see what was unique to any of these subsets. Another thing that you'll want to do is check your data prior to upload. One of the things we see really frequently is not doing QA and then having to clean up the file later. We don't necessarily want to do that as a practice. So in this case, we checked the score ratings and found there are a lot of scores that were not filled in, and those tended to be with the international reviews. When we replaced the date field, we got rid of the US prefix, but it wasn't getting everything else. So one of the things that we can do is when we check it, we can then make an educated decision on whether we want to include those reviews in our analysis or not, and make that decision as it presents itself. So next thing is when to use it. You can use it if it's publicly available online. If it's scrapable, if you can find it, you can use a scraper. All of these places have reviews, either reviews of businesses as a place to be employed or interview, places to purchase goods, places to understand movies, places to understand social conversations. There's a lot of things online where your audience is talking about the thing that you want to understand. One thing that we recommend is taking reviews from a variety of retailers in order to understand the purchasers or the community within those retailer subsets. If you want to understand what is unique to Amazon one-star experiences, you need to be able to know that Amazon is where the review came from and that they had a one-star experience. If you want to understand what Walmart buyers are saying about your product that Best Buy buyers aren't talking about, you need to have both Walmart data and Best Buy data. If you want to know how Amazon buyers feel about price compared to Walmart buyers, you need to have that data again. If you want to understand what is changing over time, you have to include the date field, that kind of thing. So if you are a requester of insights, make sure that you're including links to review pages so that the person scraping the reviews knows exactly what you're looking for. A lot of time can get wasted in the overhead having to or wanting folks to like read our minds. Don't do it. Make it easy. Show exactly what you want. And also keep in mind that the reviews are not necessarily the same as the number of ratings. So in this case, there are 12,000 ratings, but only 1,000 or so reviews. Make sure you're being cognizant of that when you set expectations. If you're on the scraping side, make sure that the requester understands that. Confirm that you have all the data needed and that what you're doing aligns with that requester's objectives.
Yes, and also it is especially helpful if you go to a site with just the reviews on it. That's why when we're navigating through this, we're not just scraping off that base Amazon page. We're going directly to where only the reviews are held, which makes it much easier once you're trying to build your sitemap.
In summary, we have the web scraper tutorial. Thank you, Lila, for presenting that. We formatted the files and we understand why we need it. Thank you, and we'll see you all next time.
Thank you.
All right, how did that feel?
Good.
I think it's gonna be fast.
It is, yeah.